propositions and then colligative properties, which are not, they're more physical processes than they are chemical processes. Now we're going to get into looking a little bit more at chemical processes. And this is going to get a little more quantitative, and we're going to use the same lens of thermodynamics to look at these types of chemical reactions, chemical equilibria is what you call them. So let's just kind of dive right in. So there's a lot of stuff. If you actually, the GChem website does a good job of kind of quickly cutting through this, but in a textbook, there's a reasonable amount of formalisms that you'll find around this stuff, because thermodynamics is, you know, it's a very formal physics-oriented subject. And I'll kind of dot around or try to maneuver around that to make things as painless as they can be. So there's a lot of really interesting stuff here, and I really like this stuff. I think this and the acid-based chapter are probably my two favorite section, like chunks of 301 and 302. So let's just get right into it. So we're talking about mass action and equilibria, and essentially what we're trying to do is we're trying to describe a chemical reaction in terms of its concentrations and relate that back to its free energy. So let's say you've got a generic chemical reaction. I'm going to say N sub A times A. So that's, you know, the number of moles times some reactant A plus, let's just look at the most basic thing we could imagine. Let's back this up just a tiny bit. Let's say you have, let's say I have one type of chemical and it just spontaneously will decompose into some other chemical. So you just have this very simple reaction where it's A and it's interconverting with B. This is this happens. This is not an unreasonable thing. Things just decompose spontaneously, like hydrogen peroxide, for example, will decompose into oxygen and water. I guess you get two things out of that, but here, so we have something that's interconverting, something A, and it's interconverting back and forth between that and B. So what's different here, like compared to the way we normally kind of talk about chemistry, is we usually just use one of these arrows, where you're saying, okay, A is being converted into B. But the reality is that nothing really completely... It's hard to think. Practically, sometimes things get completely converted from A to B. But if you look at it in detail, what you're really looking at is an equilibrium between those two. So reactant A has some free energy associated with it, and reactant B has a free energy associated with it. And the amount of B and A that form is dependent on sort of the difference between those free energies. So a more realistic way, or a more formal way to think about this, is with using these equilibrium arrows. So one thing you'll notice about the equilibrium arrows is that they're sort of like these fish hooks. So normally we draw an arrow like this. But here, we don't use that. We use these arrows that are fish hooks. And one is going forward and one is going backwards. And that is to show that this reaction is in equilibrium. You know, we're looking at the equilibrium condition or some sort of equilibrium condition there. So we can write out an expression to describe this. Let's start, this is a little bit different than the way the GChem book teaches it, but let's start by looking at what happens at equilibrium. So I'm going to put, we're going to say M and N. So those would be the coefficients, you know. So maybe you have 2 moles of A going to 1 mole of B or something like that. But we could describe at equilibrium, we could describe this reaction using this, which is called the mass action expression. But it's a way of demonstrating. It's a way of expressing what's happening at equilibrium in terms of concentrations, which is what we're really interested in chemistry. You know, we're trying to make things. And so, you know, if you're running a chemical process plant or you're making a drug or something, and you're trying to make B, and it's under some sort of equilibrium constraint, naturally you're going to be very interested in this expression because it's going to ultimately tell you exactly how much B you can form. And so you can think about that a little bit more detail. So for example, So K, let me get some terminology down here. So K, this is our equilibrium constant. And it's really just it's related to the free energy, which we'll ultimately see. But if you kind of look at it, if you take a step back, what K really is it in this simple situation at least, it tells you the ratio of products that you're going to have to reactants. So let's think about that in a little bit more detail. So if K is large, well, let's look at the most basic thing. So let's assume that M and N, you know, these coefficients here are the same. Let me step that back a little bit. Let's get rid of those. And we'll worry about that later. But let's look at this really basic case. So I've got K, and I'm saying that K is equal to the concentration of B, so these brackets, are another way of saying moles per liter. So they stand for molarity. We just can't write out molarity because in reality those should be dimensionless, and you can read more about that on the GChem website if you want, but for now just trust me on that. So we've got the concentration of B in molarity divided by the concentration of A in molarity, and we're saying that that equals this number K. If K is equal to 1, what does that tell me about the concentration of A and B at equilibrium? So when I say equilibrium, I mean like, you know, we take A and we get this reaction going and we wait a long enough time to where it settles to whatever it's, you know, whatever you want to call it, like its energy minima is. It's sat long enough to where it's at equilibrium. In the same way that if you take like a cold glass of water and you let it sit out at room temperature, it will be at equilibrium with the environment when the water warms up to room temperature. It's not changing anymore. So practically speaking, we've let this reaction run to the point where it's no longer changing. So in the beginning, maybe you have 100% A, but then as the reaction progresses and eventually equals equilibrium, now I have both of these present. And what K does, what this sort of magical number does, is it tells us or allows us to calculate exactly how much we would have of each one. So if K is equal to 1, what does that tell us about this ratio of A to B? What are some values? So you can just like imagine some different values that would give you 1, right? B could equal 10. What would that say about A? Must also equal 10. Or B could equal, you know, 0.3. What would that tell us about A? K is the equilibrium constant, meaning that it is constant as it doesn't change. If it's a constant and that can't change, then it constrains what the values are of A and B. So if I pick a value for, which is what I'm doing here, if I just pick a random value for B of 10, then what does that tell me about the value of A? Well, if this is going to be equal to 1, then this must be equal to 10, because that's the only thing that ends up being 1. If this is equal to 0.7, then I know that A must be equal to 0.7. If I know the value of A and I don't know the value of B, I still can just calculate it by looking at the equilibrium constant. So for example, if I know that the concentration of A is 0.3, what does that tell me about my concentration of B? It must also be 0.3, right? So the whole value of this, and the, you know, it's hard, it gets kind of lost, I think, because there's so much, we kind of do a bunch of fancy stuff with this, but the whole thing that we're talking, all we're really doing when we work through this problem is we're saying K allows us to calculate these concentrations. So given the value of K, I can say something about the concentrations of A and B at equilibrium. Before and after equilibrium is different, but it's a related thing. But let's just start at equilibrium because that's the simplest case. you know, like a really basic problem for this might be, let's say you've got this same reaction that we're looking at, and it says, okay, K is equal to, I don't know, let's say 10. So I made that up. And let's say that the concentration at equilibrium, so let's say at equilibrium, the concentration of A is equal to, let's say, sorry, I'm going to make this math easy. Let's call that, let's say the concentration of B is equal to 20 molar. Okay? And then it could say, like, what is the concentration of A at equilibrium? So, okay, well, I don't know. Let's think this through. So the key thing that you want to hone in on is, if I know K and the problem is fair, I'm given, I should have enough information to where I can calculate the concentrations of both B and A. And so my starting point almost always for these problems is to write out an equilibrium expression. An equilibrium expression is always the products divided by the reactants, and I'll show you how to kind of generalize that to any reaction, not just this one. But for now, let's just kind of stick with this. So I write out my equilibrium expression, which is the products over the reactants, the concentrations of products divided by the concentration of the reactants. And I'd say, okay, well, I know B is equal to 20. A is what I'm solving for, and I know that K is equal to 10. So you can, you know, plug through this and solve it, but it should hopefully be pretty obvious that in order for this to be true, A must equal 2 at equilibrium. So by knowing K, this value here, it allows me, and I know something about the final conditions, something about the final concentrations, it allows me to calculate A. That's the whole shtick with this. So we're gonna go through a whole bunch of different stuff, but ultimately, primarily what we're worried about is I have K, I wanna know what the equilibrium concentrations are of the different species involved in the reaction. That's it. So that's everything that K tells us. So K helps us, it's like, I think of it as it's like a constraint for the values of concentrations you can have at equilibrium. So I keep emphasizing this at equilibrium piece, and that's a really important piece because not everything is at equilibrium. Equilibrium is the most boring point that any situation, anything can be in. You know, all the exciting stuff is happening before equilibrium. You know, if you watch sports, which I don't really, because I'm a scientist and I think that's against the rules for us. But if you watch sports, I guess I watch the Saints because I'm from New Orleans when they do well, which is like once every 30 years. But anyway, if you're watching football, right? When is it exciting? It's exciting when like the quarterback throws the football and it's going through the air, and maybe it's exciting when the guy catches the ball and runs for a while, right? When you can kind of think about the equilibrium point as being when that stuff is over. So when the play is over, now you're at equilibrium again and things are boring again, right? So the guy catches the ball and he gets tackled. Now you're at equilibrium. Things have ended. They're kind of at their energetic minima. And then it's sort of like the next play is like you're running another chemical reaction. What's going to happen? All the exciting stuff happens. You know, they hand the ball off. Some dude runs it. He gets tackled again. Now you're at equilibrium again. Equilibrium is this really boring ass part after all the exciting stuff happens. And what K does is it just kind of tells us something about what equilibrium is going to look like. Okay, so when we're not at equilibrium, how do we know if we're not at equilibrium? Let's look at this again. So let's say that K is equal to 10. Let's say K is equal to 10. And K is equal to 10, and then we have the same reaction, A going back and forth between B. And so my equilibrium expression is the same. And you're told in the question, it says the concentration of A is, I don't know, like 15, and your concentration of B is, you know, let's say 1. What does that tell us? So I just said, right, that K is a constraint for the values of concentrations you can have at equilibrium. And I'm, this is not, you know, this is, this problem is real. Like, let's say that A is equal to 15 and B is equal to 1. Let's plug those values in and see what we get. So if I plug in 1 for B, so say B is equal to 1 and A is equal to 15. And then I think I look at that and I say, well, I know K is equal to 10, right? I know K is equal to 10. Is this true? Does 1 over 15 equal 10? No, 1 over 15 absolutely does not equal 10. So what does that tell us about this situation that I'm in this snapshot of a reaction? This is outside of equilibrium. So this reaction is not at equilibrium. At equilibrium, I know, at least at constant temperature and constant pressure or whatever, I know that K must equal 10 and that this mass action expression must also equal 10. So if that's not true, either something went wrong, like in your math, or you're not at equilibrium. So in this case, you are in a non-equilibrium state. So when you're in a non-equilibrium state, we wouldn't be able to use K anymore because that equality is not true. And instead, we just call whatever number that is Q. And so Q is not, so K is an equilibrium constant. And if you look them up, you can look them up in like tables. They'll have different K values for different things at equilibrium, different types of reactions. Q is not something that's tabulated. It's just a number. That tells you how far away you are from K. So if Q is equal to 1 over 15 and K is equal to 10, what does that tell us in terms of our equilibrium here? This is kind of how you want to be thinking about these things quantitatively. And this takes a little while to get used to, but so if I know that K is equal to A over B, or whatever, the reaction, mass action expression is equal to A over B. And at equilibrium, that should be equal to 10. And that in my non-equilibrium state, it's 1 over 15. What must happen in order for this number, in order for Q to approach 10? Okay, so this is when the chemical reaction starts to happen. Or this is like predictive of how the chemical reaction will progress is probably a better way to say it. This number, 10, is much larger than whatever 1 over 15 is in decimals or whatever, right? 10 is a whole number. 1 over 15 is a fraction. So what must happen? So the reaction is going like this. It's going from A to B, and I can either increase the amount of B that I'm forming, so shift, we would describe that as shifting the equilibrium towards the product, shift it towards B, or I can shift it towards forming more A. Which of those is going to favor getting towards equilibrium? So everything is trying to come to equilibrium in the universe. That's sort of like what physics tells us. It's like the system trying to get to equilibrium. If it wants to get there, how can that happen? Well, if currently I have this as my expression, how can I make 1 over 15 start to approach 10? If I make A large, so this is how, you know, this is how you want to kind of analyze equations. If A gets really big, is that going to make this number larger or smaller? So, like, let's say that A becomes some 100,000. So now A has changed. B would actually change as well. But is making the denominator 100,000, is that going to make this number bigger or smaller? What if I make it 1,000,000? Right? It's going to make it smaller. As A gets infinitely large, that value just goes to 0. So that doesn't help us. So we don't want the reaction, or in order to get to equilibrium, the reaction's not going to shift to form more reactants, because that's going to take us farther away. It's going to take us farther away from 10. And we know that the equilibrium constraint is that we want to be at 10. So what must actually happen there is that the equilibrium will shift to forming more B. So as B gets large, as B gets larger, that's going to make this number larger, because now the numerator is growing instead of the denominator. And that's going to eventually allow us to get to 10. So what the value of Q tells us is which direction the reaction must go in order to achieve equilibrium. So if Q is less than K, then it's going to shift to the products. Okay? You want to make... You can rationalize this stuff out, right? Shift to the products, because you can memorize this and just be like, Q is less than K, shift to products. But you can reason this out pretty straightforwardly, just using one of these simple examples. It shifts towards the products because in order for Q to become larger, the numerator must grow. This number needs to get bigger, this number needs to get smaller, and so it shifts towards the products because that's just how the math works out. For Q greater than K, we have the opposite. That's going to shift to reactants. Because that will make the number smaller. So if Q is equal to, in this example above, 1500 or something, we need that to get smaller. And since the two numbers we have to work with are B and A, In order to make Q shrink, we need to increase this number. So by increasing the numerator, we cause Q to get smaller and approach K in this case. On the other hand, when Q is smaller than K, we increase the numerator, which is another way of saying we shift the reaction towards the products. So play around with that math a little bit. I mean, you can just... Memorizing this will allow you to answer some questions, but the math behind it is not so bad, and it is very informative. And it just cuts down on the amount of stuff you have to remember. All right, what about when Q is equal to K? This is the equilibrium condition. So this is when I'm at equilibrium. Let's just say... Nothing happens. I'm at equilibrium. Okay. So I would say, I guess my recommendation trying to understand equilibrium would be to start at using this extremely simple example where you don't have to worry about any kind of having any kind of coefficients or powers to raise things to. You just have A interconverting with B. And I can write out some really simple expressions for it, like this and this. And I can ask myself, you can make up some value for K, and you can say, well, what happens when Q is above that and below that? How do these numbers have to change in order for it to adjust? And that gets you kind of into the right mode of thought for how to think about chemical equilibrium. So we want to make this more formal. So that we can kind of generalize it, because not every reaction is just one mole of this going to one mole of something else. We can write out, let's just write it out this way. So for any expression, so A, B, C, D are the coefficients. And we can write out an expression, a mass action expression, where we take the products and we put them over the reactions. And you'll notice that what I've done here is I've raised these to the power of whatever their coefficients are. And so this is how we would write, I will just call it K, because we're mostly interested in what's happening at equilibrium. But if we're at non-equilibrium, we would write out the exact same expression and we would just call it Q. So this is the equilibrium constant, or the mass action, I guess you could say, like, it's the mass action expression for being at equilibrium. So I guess to get a little bit more into, or to give some sort of graphical representation of this, because I feel like there's a lot of algebra, is if we draw out, let's say we have free energy, and it's increasing along the vertical axis. And then down here, we just have our reaction progress. Let's call it reaction progress. And so on the left-hand side, this is going to be our reactants, whatever those are. So A, B, C, D, however many we have, it doesn't matter. And then on the right-hand side, we're going to have products. And so what this means is just that as I travel from here to here, I have 100% reactants on this side. And 100% products over here. And then these intermediate zones, like here or here or something, you know, I have some reactants left, some products left, etc. I can represent that chemical reaction in terms of how its free energy will change. So in the beginning, because the reaction is happening, and reactions happen, they lower the free energy. That's sort of the whole thing, is that if something's going to happen, it's going to reduce the free energy of a system. So I'm going to start out up here, and then my free energy is going to change. It's going to drop, and it's going to be nonlinear. Until I get to a minima, let's say like right around here, and then I'm going to see that the free energy starts to pick back up again. So if a chemical reaction or anything really happens such that it wants to minimize the free energy, so chemical reactions progress until they have minimum free energy. This is like, you know, I don't know, the most broad overview you can have of thermodynamics for chemistry. Chemical reactions progress until they have minimum free energy. So everything that's happening is trying to minimize its free energy. So if in the beginning I'm at 100% reactants, so I'm starting up here at the top, I'm at 100% reactants, and then I'm traveling along here, and as I travel along this line, now I don't have 100% reactants anymore. Now I have less and less reactants, and I'm building up products. You know, so if we look at this line I've drawn down here, so like maybe here you have 80% reactants, and 20% products have formed. As I progress, progress along here, that's going to continue to change, right? So like, okay, so now I have even less reactants. You know, now maybe I have like 60% reactants and 40% products or something. And then I keep going and I hit this minimum right here. Okay. So that's whatever this point is. Here it looks like it just happens to be about 50% reactants products. It doesn't have to be. The reaction stops at that point. Because now, if it continues past its minima, it's increasing the free energy of the reaction. And that's just not how things settle in the universe, right? They try to minimize their potential energy. You can think about the macroscopic equivalent of this being, if I were to take a marble and let it roll, and this is like a hill or something, or like a boulder, and I let it roll around inside of this thing. So I've got, you know, if I think of this as just a bowl, like if I just take a bowl and I put a marble up here, right, it's going to move around. Like maybe it's going to go up here and roll around for a while. But ultimately where it ends up at is right here. So this is like the equilibrium or the min for the delta G for a marble in real life. Like if I throw I think a marble is fine, like a meatball in a bowl or something, or it's going to sink to the bottom of the bowl. Any time where it's not at that, like if you started at the top up here, right now it's not at equilibrium. And you can imagine that if it has enough energy, sometimes it might keep going and come up here. And now it's, again, not at equilibrium. It kind of accidentally passed that up, but it'll eventually come back down and settle to that equilibrium position. So there could, depending on the amount of energy in the system, you can kind of overshoot your equilibrium position a little bit, but ultimately if you wait long enough, you know that that marble is going to settle right down into the center of the bowl. And so chemical reactions are a lot more abstract to think about because you can't see them, but that's really all that's happening here is I've got a bunch of reactants and they can be converted to products. And if I wait long enough, what I'm expecting is for the mixture between the amount of reactants and products that I form to settle right there. And sometimes I might accidentally overshoot it and end up over here, and there are ways that I can be over here. But ultimately, things should always return to where that red line is. That's the equilibrium condition. So that's a way to think about equilibria. So if I'm thinking in terms of mass expressions, so let's say I'm using this, I can take points out of this. So let's say I'm an experimentalist. I can just sort of check out the reaction and look and say, well, okay, like I'm going to measure the concentrations using some sort of analytical method. And I'm going to just see what they equal. So before I actually hit the equilibrium point, let's say I know what that is because I've done the experiment before, I would refer to this number as Q. And the same thing is true over here. Like if I just pick a point over there, that would be another value. I'm going to erase this. That would be another value of Q. So these two Qs that I've written here, I'll put like a Q1 on this and Q2. Those are not the same number. Those are just like, you know, they're just values that happen along the thing. And you wouldn't expect them to be the same number. So if I'm past the equilibrium and I've formed too much product, so the marbles rolled too far to the products, it's going to have to roll back, which means that I'm going to have to convert into reactants. Okay, so that means that my Q now is too large. So here, Q is greater than K when I'm on that side. Over here, the opposite is true, right? Q1, I haven't formed enough product. So now, so we'll say Q2 is greater than K, and over here, Q1 is less than K. What about right here at this point? This is the point where Q is equal to K. That's when you're actually at equilibrium. And so that is how equilibrium constants work, and they're extremely useful, especially for chemical engineers. You use them in drugs as well, like how a drug binds to a particular target, et cetera, et cetera. These things, even, I know it's a little bit abstract, it doesn't seem like, whoa, this is really cool, but like, you use this in biochemistry, use it in chemical engineering. These things are kind of universally used in all of the different sciences that kind of rub up against chemistry. So, all right, so this is the sort of the fundamental starting point for this. So we have K, this value here. You should be extremely familiar with how to write this out, the equilibrium expression from any random thing. And we'll work on plenty of problems like that in the normal lecture time. And then just remember that if we're not at equilibrium, which is the more unusual case, then we're not talking about K anymore. We're talking about Q. Okay.